Hey everyone, welcome back to Build Fix. This is episode number 17 for July 2025, and this is my monthly series where I help people get over that first hurdle of building a gaming PC, which is choosing the parts to build with. I have two builds to go over today, and this episode's theme is trying to stick to a budget as best we can. We have one for $500, one for about $750. Build Fix is proudly sponsored by PC Part Picker.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. Okay, a few quick notes before we dive in. Build Fix starts off every month with a community post, so if you're not already subscribed to my YouTube channel, definitely do that so you can see when this post goes live. I typically choose the builds to fix or to cover from the comments that I receive down here. I also include a poll, and this is pretty much just for fun. Went with a beverage theme, and beer was by far the number one choice at 59%. And for those of you who don't drink or are underage, I'm sorry I didn't have any choices for you here. They do limit the polls to just 4 options. I should have at least added some water for the hydro homies out there. But per this post, I was looking for less expensive builds, trying to keep the price range to around $500 to $700. And I wanted to start off with two very important pieces of advice for anyone who's trying to build a PC, especially if you're trying to build a gaming PC and stick to a budget. The first suggestion is to buy used, if you can, especially when it comes to the graphics card, because the graphics card is probably going to be the most expensive part of your computer, and because the graphics card is probably going to be the most expensive part of your computer, if you can find a deal there, it can really shave a lot of dollars off of the total cost. Now, unfortunately, because the secondary market for used graphics cards and other PC hardware is volatile and can change and can vary depending on your region, it's harder for me to give advice and say, like, hey, buy this RTX 3080 for $250, because you might not have access to that. So my follow-up advice there would be to check my GPU Price Watch series for this year, that way you can have a good idea of what GPUs should cost. I have a spreadsheet that I've been updating every month, so just by taking a glance at that, you can see what GPU prices are, or what the best GPU prices are currently, and that'll give you a much better idea of if you're getting a good deal as you're browsing used parts. The second half of this advice is to try to scrounge or reuse parts from an older system, especially stuff like a case, possibly a power supply, possibly storage, but carrying over parts from an older build is a great way to cut down on the costs for a new system build, as long as those older parts maintain compatibility with your new PC. Okay, so I'm actually sort of going to add a third build to today's video, which is just to rehash the build that I did at the beginning of the summer, which was my core AM5 build. It's about a $1,000 system. I'll put a link to this in the video description down below as well. And this system for me is sort of the mid-tier parts that I would recommend most people aim for. If they're building a system, they want to get something really solid from the get-go, and they want to invest in stuff like having an upgrade path for the future and having a very solid foundation of a system that can be built out as time goes by and maybe you get some more money. This also represents the mid-tier of PC hardware where you often find the best value for your money, which is why I recommend trying to claw your way up to this level of system if you can. Because if you go higher up than this grade of components, like I did with the build 2 and build 3 going to mid-level and high-end, the price can often climb up pretty dramatically and you don't get a lot more value for your money. Similarly, if you go below this down to the more budget tier, you're often giving up a lot of performance. So that was my dilemma today as I went through the builds that I'm going to share right now, which is, where do you make those compromises? Where is it acceptable to sort of dial back to save some money while not giving up too much performance? Or of course, a system that has a nice upgrade path. So here are the comments that this first build is based on. ZachLeg1283 said, an AM5 build with all AMD for less than $750, small form factor. A small form factor usually means mini ITX, and I'd say if you're trying to stick to a budget, mini ITX is not the way to go. Those components often cost more money just because they are smaller, and if you're limited on money, that's probably more of a deciding factor for you than being limited on space. Most people have enough space to put a slightly larger system on their desk or on a shelf, or hopefully not on the floor. So another bit of advice here would be, avoid mini ITX if you're on a budget. However, micro ATX is a place where you can save some money. As KKernel69 said here, Giggity, would love to see a micro ATX build with 1440 gaming and editing capabilities. Both of my builds today are micro ATX. I did make compromises on the CPU and the memory, so editing capabilities might be a little bit limited. But here we also have the Enchanter43 asking for a $500 build for someone who games a little, but does a lot of Excel work and watches YouTube too. And then lastly, the Flagship Lab asked for an APU build. So this should probably give you a good idea of where I went with this system. Instead of the 7 usual core components of a gaming PC, we have 6, and we don't have a discrete graphics card because we're using an APU. The Ryzen 5 8500G is one of the better APUs that are out there right now. It is a 6-core, but it's not going to be quite on par with the 6-core performance of the true 6-core CPUs like a 9600 or a 9600X. That said, it's only $160 and it does have integrated graphics, so you can get by without a graphics card for now. Specifically, the integrated graphics is an AMD Radeon 740M. There's also the 8600G that upgrades those integrated graphics to the 760M. That is almost $30 more, so I don't know if it's worth the price increase. But this also comes with a stock Wraith Stealth cooler, so we don't have to add more money to drop a cooler in there as well for the CPU. Beyond that, since we're building micro ATX, we do have some less expensive motherboard options. I was looking for something that was possibly lower than $100, but if we want to maintain a chipset that has overclocking capability for the future, you don't want to go with B850, possibly B650. This ASRock B850M-X Wi-Fi has a nice combination of features, including a couple M.2 slots, integrated Wi-Fi. We don't have 4 DIMM slots for memory, but most of the time we're going to be working with a 2-stick dual channels configuration anyway. And look, it's revision 2.0, which means it must be better than the revision 1.0 that they had before. Overall though, for $130, this is a nice functional core piece of your system, and you could easily upgrade this to a higher end CPU down the line and it would still work, no problem. I would not do higher end CPU plus overclocking with this motherboard, but again, we're trying to balance our compromises, such as going with a 16 gig memory kit instead of 32 gigs. A 16 gig DDR5 kit, that's DDR5 6000, which is the speed you want to go for. 6000, 6200, maybe 6400 is going to run you around $45 to $50. This one's actually got a $30 off promo code deal on it right now. So even though I wouldn't specifically go for RGB, especially if you're on a budget, skip the RGB. But if there happens to be a deal on some good spec memory that happens to have RGB, then don't feel bad. That said, one of the first things I'd recommend upgrading for this build, or if you have a few more dollars, spend about $35 to $40 more going with a 32 gig kit rather than 16 gigs, as long as you maintain DDR5 6000 speed. And of course, go with the lowest cast latency possible. This Team Group kit is only $87. I've used this kit myself before, but of course, that's about $30 to $40 that you may not have to spend. So 16 gigs is totally fine to get you by with, and a memory upgrade down the line is a really easy upgrade to do as well. For storage, you want at least 1 terabyte. You want an SSD. You don't get a mechanical hard drive in 2025. This again is a really high value SSD. It's made by Team Group. It's not the fastest SSD ever. It has a SLC cache, but it is only about $54 for 1 terabyte. This is another potential upgrade you could go for. I wouldn't say it's as important as the memory because adding more storage is also a pretty easy upgrade. But here's why you might consider a 2 terabyte NVMe SSD to get you started, and you should be able to find those for around $90 to $100. Alright, our case is the Cooler Master Masterbox Q300L, $40, Micro ATX. It's a Cooler Master product, it's got tempered glass. There's actually a lot of really cool build examples from people in here, which is nice because you can see like some of the builds that people have wedged into this case are pretty impressive for $40. I feel like aesthetically it's not even like that much of a compromise. So this is a solid case, I'm actually using it for both of the builds today. And then for our power supply, we have a Thermaltake Smart 600 watt unit for $45. Here as well, if you're willing to spend 15 to 20, 25 more dollars, you could upgrade to higher wattage. If you want to know what wattage you should aim for, look at the graphics card you're planning to get and the recommended power supply for that. A 750 watt power supply will be able to power just about any GPU on the market outside of the ones that cost $1,000 or more, like an RTX 5080 or 5090. So the compromise we're making here is it's 600 watts, which means if we did upgrade to a higher end GPU down the line, we might need to swap out the power supply. This is a pretty basic power supply in terms of the internals. It's like a C-class power supply, so it's not necessarily that great in terms of efficiency. It is also not modular or anything like that. But again, $45, we're just trying to keep things under budget here, but that's another place you could possibly upgrade for perhaps 15 or 20 bucks more. But that is pretty much it. The total price of the system is under $500. With the iGPU, you can handle 1080 gaming, especially if you're willing to dial down the resolution a little bit. It'll depend on the game and the title that you're playing. If you are looking to upgrade this system, especially if you're looking to add a discrete GPU, such as the RX 9060 XT 16 gig that I'm going to use in the build after this, which is about $370, I'd recommend going with a different CPU. So I'd say go for the 9600X, which is currently down to $156 right now. Downside there is you would also have to add a CPU cooler because the CPUs that end with X do not include a CPU cooler typically. So for instance, we could do the 7600 non-X, which has a CPU cooler, but that's close to $200. So much better deal right now to go for the 9600X for around $160. And that is a special deal that they have at Walmart. And then add yourself a Thermalright air cooler for $35 or $40 more. But those would be my upgrade recommendations. The CPU plus an air cooler, the memory to 32 gigs for sure. And then dropping in a discrete graphics card. And again, the starter GPU for me outside of used market deals that you might find is gonna be the RX 9060 XT 16 gig right now. Don't get the 8 gig version. And happily, this card is actually selling for its MSRP of around $370. Technically MSRP is 350, but this is a 16 gig graphics card. Okay, one more build here. This is from Issue 87, a first PC build for a nephew who's gaming on a 1080, 27 inch monitor. Not sure what refresh rate this is, but we're looking at games like Marvel and Fortnite. So shooter FPS games that are not that difficult to run in terms of like needing a high end graphics card. We've even got some GPU options, B580, 7600 XT. Those are also good choices, but I'd say amongst these, I'd still go with the 9060 XT 16 gig. Then we have a 5700 CPU, 16 gigs of RAM and a 1 terabyte. Drive. HD, we're gonna go SSD there. No RGB. Since we're on a budget, the RGB considerations go out the window a little bit for me. You can always turn off RGB lighting. But the focus here is going to be on sticking to a budget and also having a discrete graphics card to add in. And the compromise we're making here is that we're building on AM4. AM4 is AMD's last gen platform. It's been around for 9 years or so now, but it is still a place where you can find some pretty solid deals. Especially you may note on stuff like the CPU and the motherboard, which helps keep our overall cost down pretty significantly. But look, our total here is coming in at about $735 right now for all of these new components. And right from the get-go, the CPU is only $78, but it's also the Ryzen 5 5500. This is a 6-core, it does come with a CPU cooler, so you don't need to add that on, cost more money. However, it is one of the dialed down 6-cores versus like the 5600 or 5600X. It has half of the cache, 16 megs instead of 32, so that does impact the performance. So I consider this to be a starter CPU in this build, and you would probably want to set your sights on something to upgrade to. Thankfully for AM4, there are lots of deals on the used market, so I'd say keep your eye out for something like a 5800X3D or 5700X3D. The 5700X3D is currently available at retail, but it costs almost $300. So that becomes a little bit harder of a pill to swallow when you're considering that you're building on a last gen platform that doesn't have an upgrade path. If you're considering spending $300 on a 5700X3D, I would say look at your AM5 options and try to invest there, especially if you're building a system that you plan to upgrade as time progresses. Now here also, again to keep costs down, we have made a compromise on our motherboard. It's an ASRock B450M chipset board, which means they're gonna be limited to PCI Express 3.0 speeds. Your PCI Express bandwidth is mostly gonna be a concern when it comes to your graphics card that's connected, and most graphics cards do not saturate the PCI Express bus. That said, with this motherboard, I am happy that the 9060 XT has a PCI Express x16 interface rather than x8. PCIe 3.0 x16 is plenty for the 9060 XT. And from there, we can move on down the line. Because we're looking at DDR4 memory, prices are still a little bit less than they have been. Prices for DDR4 are actually going up. So if you're considering an investment like this, I'd say buy soon or look on the used market because you might find better deals there than at retail. That said, we can get a 32 gig kit that's DDR4 for 3600 speed. I'd recommend between 3200 and 3600 speed for the AM4 platform. And this is only coming in at $56. For our case, we got the same case, Masterbox Q300L for only $40. And for our power supply, this represents like a $10 upgrade versus the other power supply we were looking at. This is a Tough Power GX2 80 plus gold. So we're still at 600 watts. This doesn't have any of the newer fancier connectors like a 12V2x6 or anything like that. It is still not modular, but we're looking at a nice upgrade in terms of core internal. It's 80 plus gold rated instead of 80 plus not any metal rated. And again, we're only spending about $10 or $11 more. So this is also an upgrade I would consider for that previous system. But if you're spending less than $500, even a $10 upgrade can be something you have to heavily consider. So I'm trying to keep all that in mind. But here is my $750-ish dollar build. Actually about $735 per current pricing from PC Part Picker. So if you were looking to build a system using new components right now for about this price and you didn't have much wiggle room, this is the direction I'd point you towards. But of course, don't forget my advice from the beginning of this video, which is to check the secondary market for used deals and also to keep an eye out for if you have an existing PC that you can sort of gut and reuse some of the components from, because that's a great way to save some money. Anyway though, guys, I want to say a huge thank you to PC Part Picker for sponsoring this series. I'll post links to the builds down in the video description. Also down there, you can find a link to my store at pulsehardware.net, where you can buy shirts and mugs and pint glasses to help support my channel and get yourself some awesome high quality merchandise. Thank you guys again for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.